last time you joined me here at the Sedges, I was on Canal Lake, which is the lake over the back to where we're sitting today. Today we're on Brick Lake, and again it's very hot. I'm looking at fishing long pole with pellets shallow, a slightly longer rig than normal, a little bit in between, so if I see one I can swing at it, but also so the rig's short enough for me to turn the bait over and feed and catch them like that. So I'm also feeding a line in the edge up to my right, just short of the next pallet. I found a nice little flat bit there. It's about 2-2.5 foot deep, which is perfect for these big carp. And there I'm feeding micros, corn and a little bit of meat. And hopefully as the day goes on, I should catch a few fish down the edge.
On such a hot day, the hottest since the summer of 1976, we decided to let Will concentrate on catching some fish during the first hour of the session. It was soon apparent the carp were there for all to see, but not responding to the opening tactic of regular loose feeding and working the long pole shallow rig over the top. Will quickly sussed the carp were not coming to the noise of the pellet feed. Feeding in bursts, then working the rig without feeding, saw the first bite and carp succumb in the quiet spell between the feeds. Despite the heat, Will maintained his concentration levels and ensured that he didn't miss any opportunities to top up the feed in the margin swim, leaving it for later in the session. The carp's reluctance to come to the feed was underlined when Will turned his attentions to fish he could see cruising away from the fed area. Switching to a dobbing mode with a hybrid shallow rig saw him mug a couple more fish into making a mistake. Thank you. It was hard work in the very hot weather, and we rejoined him as he netted the third carp, which, like so many of the brick pond fish, was a high single figure specimen.
I've just had a real nice ghosty, which is the third fish, caught shallow, again on 6mm pellets. It's always difficult when it's this hot because the fish are just cruising around, really not feeding. But by fishing the way we're fishing, with a slightly longer rig, around 2.5-3 foot, not only enables me to fish very accurately where I'm pinging 6mm pellets, but if I do see one, I can just swing towards it. It just gives me a little bit of freedom. And it's a way that a lot of people don't fish. They either fish a very short rig, shallow, or a very long rig for dobbing the fish. And if you do a little bit of in between, it's short enough the rig to catch where you're loose feeding, but it's also long enough to catch, obviously swinging at them. You can see the rig that I'm using there today. Just a clear Drennan dibber. Shot underneath the float. Absolutely perfect. Around a foot deep. 019 hook length, size 18 hook, and a banded 6mm. And there's 18 inches of line. That's the whole rig. There we go, there's another one. In this lake, they're all quite decent fish. You don't need many to catch a real good weight. Still a bit early for the edge, but as you see, I just take every opportunity just to have a look up the edge, just to see if I can see any fish swirling. It's a real good tip that, especially if you're in a match. A sign of the fish swirling can just give you the indication to go down there. Obviously, you don't want to waste time in a match, and until I see fish moving or signs of fish, I'll just carry on fishing shallow, nicking an odd fish. Because like I say, they're decent sized fish. Just pinging a few 6mm, turning the rig over all the time. Have a nice common. Lovely, real decent fish. Perfect. Just turn the rig over 3 or 4 times.
As the sun baked down with no shade for cover, Will worked hard with the long pole shallow. A pattern was emerging where the carp, while visible and cruising around, were backing off from the noise of the feed. Will found success targeting the fish away from the fed area, swinging the rig at them with a lone pellet hook bait. It was a game of cat and mouse, but worth it for the high average size carp in the brick pond. Will had the margin swim up his sleeve, and while waiting for signs of fish to feed there, he continued to pot in generous helpings of micro pellets, corn and cube meat at 20 minute to half hour intervals. Eventually, signs of feeding fish came in the edge, and Will decided it was time to fish there. It did not take long to get among the fish either.
As you can see, I'm getting an odd indication in the edge now. I've caught a couple of nice fish. There's another one there now. What I'm trying to do is really maintain keeping that bait right over the fed area. I don't want it to be an inch or 2 or 3 inches away from where I fed. I want it to be right on top, because that's where the feeding fish's mouth is going to be. So important. Any slow indications, I'm just ignoring, just lifting the float. And the three fish I've hooked there, the float's just rocketed under at 1,000,000 miles an hour, and that's exactly what you're looking for. They're big fish, you don't need many, you can be nice and patient. And again, that's why I use heavy floats in the edge, so that when I get an indication and miss it, I can relocate that bait really, really quickly, right on top of where I've fed. And quite often you miss a bite, drop it back in, and you catch that fish that you've missed the bite off because you've relocated your bait ever so fast. Another nice big one. Don't need many of these at all. Well into double figures. Beautiful big common. right in the top lip. And what I'm going to do now is feed again. Like I say, what I've done now, and it's a tactic that I employ a lot when I'm not fishing that line, I've been feeding micros, corn and meat, and now I'm actually fishing it, I'm just feeding meat and corn. And what this does, this really does cut out the amount of liners you get, but also it cuts out the amount of other fish, nuisance fish, skimmers and roach you get in your peg. And you'll notice now I'm in line with my marker, dropping everything in nice and tight. And then I can just position my rig right on top of that. It's vitally, vitally important to be as accurate as you can. That way, like I said, you'll eliminate a lot of foul look fish. And it's so easy to see by the speed of the bite if the fish is going to be hooked properly. Like I say, I've not struck at anything slow. I've hooked four fish in the edge now. Every single one's been flush in the top lip, and that's a sign that not only are you fishing accurate, but you're fishing the correct depth and fishing just touching bottom. And it's a case of just getting nice and patient. They're big fish, don't need to rush. Make sure that all the bait's fed correctly, the rig's positioned correctly, and then you're just a case of waiting and keeping that bait. See, it's just drifted out a little bit, so I just lift it out. Hold the float right where I've fed, so the bait swings in underneath. That's perfect. Really trying to fish as accurate as I can and waiting for those real quick indications. See there, nice little slow indication. I didn't even flinch, didn't even think about striking. When it rockets under at 100 mile an hour, again, it's just drifted towards me a little bit. Drop it in, hold the float right where I've fed, let it all swing down parallel. And then again, I reposition my rig. As soon as I think my rig's not on top of my bait, I lift it out and reposition it so that it is. Vitally, vitally important, because if you start fishing away from where you've fed, you're asking for trouble. You're not going to get many indications. And nearly all the indications... That was a bite then. Rocketed under. And a lot of the indications you get if you're not fishing accurately enough will result in foul look fish. See how slow that indication was. Really looking for those lightning fast bites where that fish has just hoovered that bait up. Takes a little bit of practice to not react every time your float goes under. But again, if you can get out on the bank, have a good practice. Try and be really strict with yourself that you're not going to strike at anything that's slow. Anything that's really slow and deliberate, but fast. Any quick movements is going to result in a fish hooked properly. Beauty with these bigger floats, 4x14s, you really can reposition your bait quickly. So important for these big fish. Also, you can probably see that I've got quite a little bit of float showing, and again, that aids me at not striking at every single indication I get. Got a good half, three quarters of an inch of float showing. And when you do get a proper bite off a carp, it's just wallop gone. And they're the ones that you've got to strike. You do still miss an odd bite because they can reject the bait quite quickly. But the last thing you want to be doing is foul looking these fish, because you don't get hundreds of bites off them. They're quite wary. They're big fish. Case of just trying to make everyone count, fishing for one at a time. We're not going to give it too much longer today because it's unbelievably hot. It's probably the hottest I've ever fished in England, to be fair. Just a little mention about the rig again, nothing flash, just the bulk, 6 inches above the hook. 020 direct and a size 14 gamma carp hook. Again, I put a lot more emphasis on the accuracy of feeding, plumbing up, fishing in the right place of your peg. Find a nice little shallow bit, not too deep, 2 foot, 2.25 foot maximum. These are the real important things. Like here at the Sedges, the fish are in fantastic condition. They're big, they're fit, they're going to really fight. So there's no reason to fish light at all. You must fish heavy. I've only fished single corn because when the carp have turned up, all the other fish, the roach and the skimmers, seem to have gone. So like I say, I've learned a little bit about this lake. There's definitely fish in the margins. And it was the same when I fished the canal lake. They didn't seem to come to a lot of noise when you're fishing shallow. Literally just laying your rig in and pinging a few pellets seemed really good. And that's a little bit unusual because on a lot of venues I go to, the carp really respond to noise. So that's something I've definitely learnt. Obviously, if it was a match, I might fish a bit closer to me unless it was every other peg. Always like to try and fish at least the top six. But all in all, I think it's been a fantastic exercise. Again, accuracy in the edge is vitally important. Plumbing up, feeding, rig positioning, absolutely deadly. We've not foul-hooked a fish down there. We've only had four, but they've all been big fish, close to 10 pound, and we've not foul-hooked one. And that's the sort of thing you want to be doing. You don't want to be hooking six and getting three in. You know that you're fishing accurately, in the right depth, and the rig position's right. When you catch four, don't lose any, miss a couple of bites, everything's good. As far as the long pole, again, it was really just working hard for a very, very odd bite. But again, like I've already said, it's been blisteringly hot today, well over 30 degrees. And I think we've done well to put together the net of fish that we have. We haven't had loads of fish, maybe a dozen fish, but probably close to 100 pounds. And that's the quality of the fish here at Sedges. Not only are they big, they're in perfect condition, but they pull your arm off. And like I say, that's another reason when I was fishing shallow, I wasn't fishing light at all. A 16 MWG to 020 match winner. Just a banded 6mm. And again, you know, not making too much noise. Just nice and relaxed. Just laying the rig in. As one came along, it would have it. Really interesting fishing. But like I say, it's unbelievably hot. And I think in a minute, I'm going to call it a day. And we'll have a little look at the fish that we've managed to put together. You may have noticed in today's session I've been using the new Darwa roller. It's a fantastic bit of kit, especially when you're fishing commercials with a long pole. You can see it rocks. It's also got two rollers which takes the whole weight of your pole. And the best thing about it when you're kinder potting, it takes that slight vibration out that you get on a single roller. It's absolutely fantastic. And like I say, the less spillages you get when you're kinder potting, the better. You need to feed accurate, and it's little things like decent rollers that will really up your game and make you good at that style of fishing. Well, there we go. There's a small part of the catch we put together here at the Sedges today. Fantastically strong fish in brilliant condition. If you've not been here, get here and have a go, because there's plenty of these in here.